from Jeremiah, the 32nd chapter and the 17th verse. Oh Lord God, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and the outstretched arm. There is nothing too hard for you.
To my friends and all the rest of you. You know, God loves us. He loves us more than, as the pastor said this morning, more than anything else, more than anyone else. So this morning, you voted me into membership in this church. Some of you may regret that vote, I don't know. But you're stuck with me now. And when you ask a scientist to come and be part of your community and then you give him a microphone, you're in for it. I preached on Einstein's relativity and this morning on creation. Now, usually I've done many, many presentations on creation through the years as a biologist. And it's usually a 3-hour session. But this morning, because of you, it's going to be less than 2 hours. Amen. Let's bow our heads for a word of prayer. Father, we're so thankful that you are the creator of the universe, that you, through that creation, tell us every single day as we look at the colors that we see, at the blue sky and hear the birds and the animals, you tell us every day how much you love us. Tell us again this morning in our hearts how much you love us. In Jesus' name, amen. I was going through my things the other day and I came across this. You know what it is? This is the claw of a mini Tyrannosaurus rex. It's a claw. Now, we have a cat at home right now that we're fostering, and the claws aren't quite that big. I also came across this. That's the lower jaw of that same mini Tyrannosaurus rex. And to go with it, here's the upper jaw. And they hinge something like that. Pretty cool, huh? You know, Satan tries to counterfeit everything, right? He tries to counterfeit marital intimacy. He tries to counterfeit the Sabbath. He tries to counterfeit everything. Is that right? Now, I don't want to put myself in that boat, but these are counterfeit. These actually were printed on a 3D printer. They're plastic. And to me, it's just as amazing that we can create, that we can do something like this with plastic than it is that these are actually replicas of real bones? Did I create these when I made these out of plastic? Did I create them? No, I just replicated something that's already there, right? I replicated something that's already there. I'm going to put these down here in the front, so if some of the children want to come and look at them, they can handle them. Or some of the rest of you, older children. Creation is a very, very important topic for us as Christians and for us as Seventh-day Adventists. So I'm going to pick on some of my friends. Is that all right? You know that I love you, so if I pick on you, then you know I love you that much, much more, right? Jerry says, I don't know about that. Sheila, my first victim, explain to me the physics of light. The physics of light. You don't have to answer. Is light real? Do you see light? Can you explain all the physics of light? Light has mass and energy, and it travels 610,000 miles a second. We can't understand that. Grace, this morning for breakfast, I had this fantastic piece of bread. It was great. Explain to me how a microwave works. Do you use a microwave? Yes, but we don't totally understand how it works, do we? How about your cell phone? How about the nature of God? Do we understand the nature of God totally? Pastor, you're a theologian. Do you totally understand the nature of God? No. Just because we don't understand something, we're not able to describe it, we're not able to tell you every little piece about it, doesn't mean that it's less real. Do you agree with that? I'm a gestaltist. That's not a bad word. I like to know the whole picture. I like to see everything that's there, and then when I get the pieces, I have hooks to hang them on. Does that make sense? If I get a piece of knowledge, I know where to put that piece of knowledge, where it fits in the whole. I'm a gestaltist. So this morning, we're going to talk about God is God, and we cannot fully understand how he works or even how he thinks. We don't understand all that. Creation is important to Seventh-day Adventists. We're going to talk about why it's important. Short chronology versus long chronology. There are many Christians today, theistic evolutionists, in the Seventh-day Adventist Church that believe that the earth is millions of years old, and that we're going to talk about theistic evolution. We're going to talk about the Sabbath. The Sabbath doesn't exist without short chronology. If God created on the first day, and it took a million years to do that, and it took a million years for the second part of creation, and a million years for the next part of creation, the sixth day, and man went from ape to man in a million years, then how do we deal with the Sabbath? Is the Sabbath a million-year process? today. We're going to talk about the relationship of creation to salvation. And lastly, we're going to talk about worldview. Your worldview that you hold determines how you think about not only creation, but about everything else as it relates to God. So I'm going to quickly go through, just as a review, the days of creation. Day one, let there be light. It was good, and the evening and the morning were the first day. Day two, let there be a firmament in the midst of the waters. And God called the firmament heaven, and it was good. And the evening and the morning were the second day. The third day. Oh, hit the wrong button. There we go. The third day. Let the waters be gathered together and let dry land appear. Then he said, let the earth bring forth grass, herbs, and fruit trees. And God called the dry ground earth and gathered the waters together into seas. And God saw that it was good, and the evening and the morning were the third day. Fourth day, let there be lights in the firmament to divide the day from the night, and let them be signs and seasons for days and years. God made two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night. He made stars also, and God saw that it was good, and the evening and the morning were the fourth day. Day five. Let me just pause for a second. Do you like this artwork? This artwork that was done by a friend of mine, Nathan Green. He has donated all seven of these photos to every school, every academy in North America. Every academy has a framed print of these pictures, the ones that I've shown this morning, in the schools in North America, because he believes in creation. And we as a church want our children to understand that creation is central to our philosophy. Let the waters abound with living creatures, and let the birds fly above the earth and across the face of the firmament. And God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the waters in the seas, and let the birds multiply on the earth. And God saw that it was good, and the evening and the morning were the fifth day. Day six. Let the earth bring forth the living creatures according to his kind, and it was so. Let us make man in our own image, according to our likeness. Then God blessed them and said to them, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and every living thing that moves on the earth. And the evening and the morning were the sixth day. And God saw what he had made, and indeed it was very good. I love that. It was very good. Thus the heavens and the earth and all the hosts of them were finished. And on the seventh day, God ended his work and he rested. And God blessed the seventh day and sanctified it, because in it he rested from all of his work which God had created and made. Creation story in Genesis. It's also in Revelation. The creation story is all the way through Scripture, from Genesis to Revelation, from the three angels' messages to the story of salvation. It is a foundational tenet in which the Christian life is based. In Scripture, I'm not a Hebrew scholar. Sometimes I can't even speak English. But in Hebrew, in biblical Hebrew, the word day, and throw something, Pastor, if I get off here, just throw something, is yom. And so yom is used 2,301 times in the Old Testament, totally. It is used 410 times outside of Genesis with a number. It's used with evening and morning 46 times just in the Old Testament. All references to the word day in Genesis use the word yom. So on it was in the evening and the morning were the fifth yom. That's what the Scripture says. Every single one of those references in the Old Testament refer to a literal 24-hour ordinary day. It doesn't refer to a million years or to a period of time or a process that happened over a long period of time. It refers to a literal, ordinary 24-hour day. Jesus confirmed the historical nature of Scripture 42 times in what Jesus said in the New Testament. He refers to creation 42 times, or he refers to the flood, or he refers to the historical nature of what happened, the crossing of the Red Sea, Jonah, all of the stories that Jesus refers back to those historically. In Matthew, he says, "Have you not read that he who made them at creation made them male and female?" God made man. "For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark, and they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. That is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man." See, Jesus uses the historical text to tell us what's coming in the future. This is just one example of that. If we were here for our 3 hours, I would share with you that research has been done. There's a very famous PhD that's done. He has a PhD in physics and a PhD in biblical languages, and he's an Old Testament scholar, on and on and on and on. And he's actually analyzed the text in the Old Testament. And the way that the texts are put together, when people are telling stories, they use verbiage in a certain way, right? Once upon a time, is that a fact? If I say to you, "Once upon a time, Mel had a headache," is that a? And now I tell a story about Mel. It's a story, right? I'm not really held to the facts. I can tell a story about Mel. And I can kind of embellish it a little bit. Oh, of course, I wouldn't do that. But if I say, "I was at the hospital the other day and I saw Mel and this would happen and that would happen," you knew that what I was telling you was historical fact, because I'm telling you, you can tell by how I say it whether it's fact or whether it's a story. Does that make sense? Well, this PhD has taken the Old Testament and the stories in the Old Testament and done that kind of chronology, that kind of study. And he says it's 99.5% true that the creation story is an historical story, not a fable, not a fanciful fable. And I'd show you all the different ways and all the biblical texts, but we're going to move on. These things really happen, not a story or the result of millions of years of evolution. Paul, also in the New Testament and other New Testament prophets, also confirmed the Genesis account story. Based on their understanding, and they based their understanding of Christ and of salvation on the foundation of the Genesis creation account. Creation is carefully woven into the fabric of Scripture and is the foundation of the Christian faith. All the way through Scripture, creation is there. God created the heavens and the earth. Worship Him who created. All the way through Scripture, even to Revelation, you can find where God continues to say that He is the Lord. He is the creator of all things. Now, my friend Dan Jackson. Many of you know Dan Jackson. He was the president. I just talked to Dan this week. He's moved to Salmon Arm, British Columbia. Salmon Arm, a little burg in the middle of nowhere. And he is happy as a clam. He always says, if you don't preach Jesus in the doctrine of the Sabbath, stop preaching about the Sabbath. If you don't preach about Jesus when you talk about the sanctuary, stop preaching about the sanctuary. If you don't preach about Jesus when you talk about the love of God, stop preaching about the love of God. Because Jesus has to be the center of every one of what we talk about. Do you believe that? Do you buy into that? See, I believe that's true, and I believe that our doctrine as a whole is based on a foundation of the love of Jesus, the love of God for each one of us. And creation is at the foundation of that. God, through creation, is telling us how much He loves us. So if we take the chronologies, and again, I would go through all of this, I'd bore you with all of this, and I put all those chronologies up on the screen, and Adam lived 960 years, and Seth lived, and we'd add those all up, and we could come up with a number. And we can verify those numbers other places other than just in Scripture. We can take the historical record and the scrolls, the Dead Sea Scrolls and other things, and we can verify the length of time. Another whole section that I left out of this is if you plot all of those years through time, they were all hundreds of years until the flood. And after the flood, the number of years for every single person went down. And we're down to 70 or 80 years. Adam lived how many years? 960, is it? Imagine living 960 years now. Nobody would want to live 960 years now, would we, in the condition this world is in? You see, I believe, and I think Scripture points out, that something changed at the flood. People ask me all the time, and I have a whole lecture on dinosaurs and what were dinosaurs real and all of those kinds of things. Dinosaurs were real. They were there. I mean, this isn't, I have to be careful how I say it. This isn't a fabrication. It is, but it's, the real bone is there. Southwest Adventist University has this bone. They made a copy for me so I could have it to do presentations. But the bone is real. That animal lived at one point in time. It was real. People ask me what happened to dinosaurs. I believe everything changed at the flood. I think our atmosphere changed at the flood. How many of you see birds flying around with the wingspan of an F-16 fighter? The pterodactyl had the wingspan of an F-16 fighter jet. How many of you have seen dragonflies with a wingspan of 4 feet? That actually, we have fossils that show that those things existed. Today, with the air the way it is on planet Earth, a 5-foot wing dragonfly could not fly. A pterodactyl could not fly with the physics that are needed because of the density of the air, et cetera, et cetera. Things changed at the flood. And we lost the dinosaurs after the flood. Back to this. If we take creation, when Adam was created, his 960 years, you add it in to the chronology of Seth and all of the descendants from Adam to Abraham, and then from Abraham to Calvary, and from Calvary to the present day, you get approximately 6,000 years since Adam. Now, lots of people will say, well, it's not quite that way. It could be 10,000 years. It could be, you know, we don't know. Were you there? How many of you were there at creation? I'm old, but I'm not that old. Nobody was there at creation that's living today. Is that right? Everyone that ate tofu in 1800 is dead, so tofu must be dangerous, right? Amen. We use that kind of logic sometimes when it comes to creation, when it comes to the fossil record, when it comes to things that have to do with science. None of you were there. So it takes faith to believe in the Genesis account, right? You have to have faith to believe in the Genesis account. But how many of you were there millions and millions of years ago when some spark hit the primordial soup and began life in the primordial soup? How many of you were there? None of us were there. Didn't happen, but it takes the faith to believe in millions of years of evolution resulting in a planet and the universe we have now. It takes faith. It takes faith both ways. And you see, I personally believe that God gives us enough information in Scripture, enough scientific information, that if you have faith in Him, that you'll believe Scripture. He doesn't tell you every single little detail. It still takes faith. An example is the planetary motion. I'm just going to use one example this morning. Mercury is circling around the sun at 106,000 miles an hour. Around the sun. Venus, 78,000. Earth, 67,000 miles an hour. Man, hold on. We're traveling at 67,000 miles an hour around and around the sun. Mars, 54,000. Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. That's just a slowpoke. Neptune's only going 12,000 miles an hour around the sun. But the sun is traveling at almost 500,000 miles an hour. So you have the sun that's traveling in a large arc at 500,000 miles an hour, and all these planets are circling the sun. If you change the rotation speed, even by a fraction of a percent, if all of a sudden Earth starts going slower around the sun, then it's going to, its orbit's going to increase, right? Centripetal force forces that orbit out. And if its orbit goes out, and if it's in the same plane with another planet, what happens? It ruins your whole day. If you change any of this by even the fraction of 1%, everything falls apart. Now, all of you are familiar with this. And I think if Andrew were sitting over there, we miss you, Andrew, if you're there. He was sitting over there. He could tell us about every one of those planets. He could tell you the order from the sun of every one of those planets. Who else could? Others? Yeah, there you go. So you've seen this before, Lily, right? You understand this. Is this the way that our solar system works? In reality, is closer to this. You see, the sun is streaking along at 490,000 miles an hour, and every one of those planets are circling the sun. And so you can see, is there a laser for you? Yeah. There was a second ago. All right, the laser. Not going to work on here. You see this one that's right there at the top going really slow down here at the bottom? Well, that's the one that's going slow around it. And so it's got this long helical arc. And the ones that are moving faster have that smaller arc. But it's more complicated than even that. Because as they're moving, as they're flying through space, they're also staying in a plane so that they stay the same distance from each other. From the sun is always, we know exactly where it's going to be. We can calculate where it's going to be every day. I go out at night, and even though there's still a lot of light in Eagle, I can look up, and I have a thing on my phone. I have an app on my phone that shows all of the constellations. And if you don't have something like this, I encourage you. It's great. You can't see it here because there's too much light, but it shows you all the constellations. And you can point it at a piece of sky, and it will tell you what the constellation is and what the planet is. And you can actually see on your phone all the space junk that's out there. And if you hover over a piece of space junk, it will tell you that this is part of the Skylab from 1986. And it will tell you what that piece of, and it's a free app. I encourage you to, it's called Skyview. But I go out at night and I stand on my back deck and I look up at the heavens. And I can, lately, Mars and Saturn have been so beautiful. They're right there, just not far apart. And you can see them just as clear as day. And I've seen them arc across the sky. They used to be in the northeast quadrant. And they've moved over the last couple of months, over the summer. And they're now in the southeast quadrant. They've moved across the sky. And you can see them go past the moon. And next year, on the same day, if you go out and look, you will find them in the same place. My point is that it's got to be pretty precise, right? So here's the question. It's a physics question. If the sun is traveling in a line at 490 miles an hour, how fast is Earth moving in a straight line? It's moving, 69,000 miles an hour in a circle. How fast is it moving forward? Exactly the same, 490,000 miles an hour, because it's staying in the same plane. If it was going slower, it would lag behind, right? And for you physicists that, if you have two axes, the x-axis and the y-axis, that the speed is independent of the other axis. So it's got to be traveling 490,000 miles this way and 69,000 miles this way, and so they can get this helical swirl through space. And if it slows down a little bit, it lags behind, and all of a sudden the sun is away from us, we get cold. If we change the angle in which we rotate even a quarter of a degree, then one side of the Earth begins to boil, and the other side begins to freeze. I could talk to you about the complexity of the eye. I could talk to you about the endocrine complexities in the body. How if you have too much of this hormone or too much of that enzyme or too much or too little of this, then your body starts to decay. We know that, right? As humans, we have to have everything exactly right. How do you put all that together and think that it happened by chance? Is that Yeah, it all happened as an accident, right? For me, in my house, we believe that God Almighty created the heavens and the earth, and He did it in 6 days, and He rested the seventh day, and blessed the seventh day, and He's asking us to do the same. Talk about theistic evolution. How many of you were apes one time? Yeah, a couple of you said you were. I guess sometimes as parents we think, never mind. Amen. Sometimes women and their husbands, but that's beside Neanderthals. Some people believe that we started out as an ape, and we got more and more complex over time, and that natural selection, that walking upright was better than walking on all fours. And so natural selection said that those that were walking more upright had more mobility, and so they were more successful. And because of that, their gene pool then got together, and more upright apes were born than those walking on all fours. And so over time, because of natural selection, we got more and more upright. Don't ask me where the briefcase came from, because that's definitely not a progression of evolution. Theistic evolution, the definition in Wikipedia today, yesterday, theistic evolutionism, evolutionary creationism, or God-guided evolution are views that regard religious teachings about God as compatible with modern scientific understanding about biological evolution. People believe today, you think it's a few people? We'll look at that in a minute. Believe that, well, let me back up. In a former life, I worked with a number of 13 of our colleges and universities in North America. And through one of our evaluations, we found some of those universities were teaching theistic evolution in Adventist colleges and universities. Because the professors who got PhDs in biology could not give you a good answer for some of the things they saw in the real world. And so the only way that they could reconcile what they saw with Scripture is to change Scripture so that it then answered the questions they found in science. Is that the way it works? God started it all, then stood back and watched for millions of years without interfering or doing only some gentle guiding. So God started it, touched the primordial soup, those first few amino acids and proteins began to come together. Life, very, very primitive life, but life began, and then it started to evolve. And sometimes He had to tweak it a little bit to keep it on track, but He was an absentee landlord. He started it and then walked away and let it move forward on its own, in its own way. That's theistic evolution. That God's an absentee landlord. And that, yes, God is involved, and yes, God tweaks things to make sure that they stay where they need to stay. Or he adds a little bit of this, or he subtracts a little bit of that. But then he walks away and lets it continue for millions of years. If you believe that, if you believe that God in theistic evolution started it back there at the primordial soup, and everything then progressed all the way up, then who created death? Where did death begin? Death began and was created by God, because all those intermediary forms had to die all the way along until we got to where we are. So if you believe in theistic evolution, then you have to say that God is inept, uncaring, unconcerned, or he's not involved with human race. Yeah, so the question is, for those of you online, when did God put a soul into the ape? Well, he must have just done that in one of his little tweaks, right? If death already existed, created by God at the Big Bang, then Jesus did not have to die at Calvary to pay the price of sin caused by man's fall. You see, now we're coming full circle. If there's no creation, there's no creation week, we don't feel that the story of creation is a real story in the Bible, a real historical event, then the fall of man in the Garden of Eden is just a story. But sin happened not because God created it, but because man disobeyed God. And sin happened. And if you believe in theistic evolution, then salvation is impossible because God didn't pay a price for the sin of man. Why would you send your son? Why would you send your son, a third of the Godhead, to this planet to die a cruel death if you weren't paying the price for something that we had done? Wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. For God so loved the world. How precious is your unfailing love. You, Lord, are forgiving and good, abounding in love, abounding in steadfast love and faithfulness. His steadfast love endures forever. He will quiet you by his love. I can go on and on. 551 times, Scripture talks about the love of God. The love of God does not exist in an evolutionary world. The love of God does not exist in a theistic evolution world, because God is a absentee landlord. He doesn't care about you. We're just now, there's no need to pray to someone who's not listening. Is that right? If God is this uncaring person, there's really no need to pray. We are not seen as his children, only as the current rendition of the evolutionary process, if you believe that God is not personally involved. Sin is not important. Your sin is just where you are. It doesn't matter whether you sin, because you're not breaking any law. No sin, no need for a redeemer, no heaven or hell. So Pew did some research, and they found that in the U.S., 33% believe in a creation story, creation historical events. 60% believe that we evolved over time. And of that 60%, 32% believe that it's due to natural process, and 24% believe in theistic evolution, that God did some tweaks along the way, but he was involved. So then they looked at denominations, and they looked at evangelical and Protestant and Catholic. The white evangelicals, 38% believe that of the creation story, that Genesis is a literal account. 4% felt like it was just due to natural processes. 58% believe, 58% believe in theistic evolution. Black Protestants, 66% believe in theistic evolution. White mainstream Protestant, where would Seventh-day Adventist fall in this spectrum? In the white mainstream Protestant, right? Of our group, 53% believe in theistic evolution. 30% believe in Darwinian evolution that happened over millions of years. Only 16% believe in creation. Is this a story we need to tell? It is. I was hopeful before COVID that we could have a seminar in the Meridian Church on creation. I know most of the leading creationists in our church and in other churches. We've done 10-day workshops in St. George, Utah, with hundreds of biologists. And I could bring some of those to this church, and they could talk about turbidity currents, and they could talk about all kinds of things, the Morikopian shale and how that shale layer is across hundreds of thousands and thousands of miles, the same thickness because the flood laid it down at a certain time. They could talk to you and share with you the intricacies of creationism and the science that now is helping to build the science, the theological significance of the flood. But we can't do that. Your worldview, how you see the world, what you use as a filter to read what's right and wrong and what's true and false. Everyone has one. Everyone has a worldview. That worldview can change. Now, there are those that feel that the worldview is imprinted by the age 13, and that worldview cannot change. If that were true, then evangelism would be dead. If you can't change your worldview, you can't change from a theistic evolutionist to a Bible-believing creationist, then there's no sense in having evangelism. Does believing in a six-day creation really matter? I submit to you that it does matter. You see, a worldview is where you believe there's truth. Is truth found in this book? Is this where truth is found? Or is truth found in the scientific laboratory? And theistic evolutionists believe that science is truth. And so they try to change the Bible to fit what they see in the laboratory. We used to believe that the world was flat, right? That was scientific truth. We know that that's no longer true. We used to believe that the atom was the smallest particle of matter. But now we know that there are quarks and all kinds of subatomic particles, even inside nuclei and electrons. Science changes. Does this change? God does not change. sense, your worldview is, do you believe in Jesus or do you believe in Darwin? In the crudest sense. So I submit to you this morning that creation does matter. It matters eternally. If you believe in theistic evolution and that God is uncaring, doesn't care about you, then you're on a different path. See, God does care for you. He's involved in your personal life. He sees you on the sidewalk walking your Cocker Spaniel. And He speaks to you. And He helps you to understand how much He loves you. God sees you as you struggle with COVID. God sees you as you struggle with the political strife that's in your world today. He sees you when you have those days with your husband and your wife, which we all have. He sees you and understands. He sees you when you lose a loved one. And He loves you, and He wants to be part of your life. Not because He's this powerful being that wants to manipulate you or use you as a puppet, but He loves you because you're His child. He wants to put His arms around you and love you. And He showed us that at creation, and He's showing us that today in all that He does. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Father, we know the home because we see around us the turmoil that this world has fallen into. Father, we look to You as our Creator, as our God, as our Father, and we ask You, Father, to wrap Your arms around us again today. Help us to understand that You love us no matter what. You love us with an unconditional love, and that love has been there since creation. Has been there since Calvary, and is there today, and will be there as You come in the clouds of glory. Father,